Hello. Today marks the beginning of the next week in our creationtide season. And today, the gospel reading is about forgiveness. And St. Paul's epistle from Romans is all about finding joy and peace in our community. So that's the theme for today. I'm standing in front of the organ and in the middle of the choir stalls, because today all our music is provided by our choir and organ, pre-recorded at their rehearsals here. So we shall hear them and see them and sing with them as a prelude to our first service, God willing, live in church on a Sunday morning on the 27th of September. So, we pause for a moment to remember our Lord's presence with us. And so we begin. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Our first hymn, a hymn of praise. Praise my soul, the King of Heaven. God has told you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? It is good to be together, God, on these screens with these people, together listening for your voice, united by your Spirit. In this time of worship, tell us about your kingdom of kindness so that we can seek it. Show us your justice. We want to walk with you humbly, closely, daily. Amen. And a prayer of confession. In the day of our trouble, we will call to you, for you will answer us. When we have done what is wrong and displeasing in your sight, O Lord, extend your love to correct us. When we ignore those in need and pretend that all is right with the world, O Lord, help us to face the truth. When we turn a blind eye to those who have been stricken with poverty and are facing injustices that come along with it, O Lord, teach us your way. Enable us to extend your love and give us an undivided heart that we may fear your name. Hear these words of assurance from Psalm 130. If you, O Lord, kept a record of my sins, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness. This is the good news. Thanks be to God. Let us sing another hymn now, a hymn for guidance. Lead us, Heavenly Father, lead us. Collect for this week. Faithful Lord, whose steadfast love never ceases and whose mercies never come to an end, grant us the grace to trust you and to receive the gifts of your love new every morning in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now our first reading.
The reading is taken from Romans Chapter 14, verses 1 to 12. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarrelling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall. And they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honour of the Lord. And those who eat, eat in honour of the Lord, since they give thanks to God. While those who abstain, abstain in honour of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, As I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then, each of us will be accountable to God. This is the word of the Lord.
The hymn before the gospel today is Through the Night of Doubt and Sorrow.
The Gospel reading for today is taken from Matthew chapter 18, beginning at verse 21. Then Peter came and said to him, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times? Jesus said to him, Not seven times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, "Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything." And out of pity for him, the lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, "Pay what you owe." Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, "Have patience with me, and I will pay you." But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he should pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, "You wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you?" And in anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he should pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. This is the word of the Lord.
Let's go back to our reading from Romans, from chapter 14. Paul talks about people who are weak in faith and people who are strong in faith. What does he mean? Well, he doesn't mean physically weak or strong. Secondly, it's not about our eating preferences. So if you're vegetarian, I hope you weren't insulted. He's not saying vegetarians are weak and carnivores are strong. No. What he's saying is it's about wanting to go back to the old ways versus being wanting to do new things going forward into the future. The Roman Church, in the company of the Church throughout the ages, was divided between people who felt that they should follow the law, keep the old ways, follow their rituals, and those who were eager to move forward, to, as they feel, listen to the Spirit and do new things. Throughout the Church and its history, this has often led to what we call a split, a gathering of people who can't agree with each other splitting up. So I suspect that Paul is writing to the Romans against a background of disagreement in the church there. Those who said that those new to faith must stick to the law and its practices to be righteous before God, and those who said, "No, we are in Christ, we are free, and we are free not to observe these things, special days and special practices, and you're stronger in your faith if you don't, because you're a disciple of Christ." If you explore further the history, you find that most often when these disputes arise, it's in time of uncertainty. Certainly, when Paul was writing to the Romans, there was a beginning of persecution against Christians. The Roman Empire was beginning to see them as trouble, and indeed local people from different faith groups and communities saw them as odd and were beginning to persecute them too. They weren't quite sure which direction to go in. And throughout the last 2,000 years, there have been periods in the life of the church when things have been uncertain, unsure, unclear. Some have wanted to go back to what they knew, to what they understood and what they believed was right. Some have wanted to move forward into a brave new world. Think about the Reformation, for instance. But let's focus on 2020. We are in the midst of a background of uncertainty. Our COVID 19 situation has led us to have various restrictions, led us to be careful about what we do and don't do, and every time there's a new rule that apparently is simpler to follow, people get more confused, it seems. And so we look at the church. What should we be doing here? What's our new normal? Surely it should be the old normal versus no, it should be completely different. Many institutions in our society are doing the same exercise. Workplaces, community centres, local authorities, all sorts of different sections of society and workplaces and hobby groups and faith groups, all of us trying to work out the best way to go forward. It's easy to see, isn't it, that that can lead to some real disagreement. But again, we need to think about why. Probably because periods of uncertainty are at the very least unsettling, often threatening, and certainly fearful. And when we're threatened, when we're fearful, when we're uncertain, we look for something to hold on to, don't we? Which might be the past, or it might be the future, but the present is too uncomfortable. So, we have our separate beliefs and passions. Backwards or forwards? Well, I'll share mine. My passion has always been forwards. Ever since I was young, I've been excited by new things, new ideas, exploring different ways of doing things, whether that be in my private life or my professional life. And in my career as a priest, I've always had that inclination to go for it because it's going to be new and different and hopefully better. Likewise, some of you will no doubt have the opposite passion. Passion that what's important is the stability of our tradition, its value, the foundation of it, and so on. Now then, there's a lot of Old Testament precedent for this, isn't there? Effectively, it's back to Egypt or forward to Cana. Because at the moment, today, it is not a good place to be. It's not a comfortable place we're in. So we're tempted to go back, to get passionate about the past, or to go forward and get passionate about the future. And as I've already said, I'm passionate about the future. That's just how I'm wired. But what Paul is addressing is not those differences, it's how they're expressed and the atmosphere in which they're explored. That arrogance that says, my passion is the right one and your passion is wrong. I'm strong in faith and you are weak. This is what Paul is talking about. He's talking about what causes the division and the quarrels that come from these different held passions, views, beliefs. Paul has three things he wants to say to them. Firstly, he wants them all to hear, as he puts it in verse 6, everyone is doing what they're doing to honour God. It isn't that one group are doing something which is contrary to living under God. Rather, they just have different ideas and thoughts about what that means. So, everyone, he said, is doing what they believe in. Nobody is going away from the faith. Nobody is wanting us to give up on Jesus. Secondly, he points out that in that honouring of God, we are all equal. We are one in Christ. And so we're not going to base our divisions and our quarrels and our opinions on people's station in life, or their culture, or their race, or their background, or their gender, or their sexuality, or whatever else we find ways to discern different people in our community. Paul says, no, we are all honouring God. We are all equal in Christ, as Jesus said, neither Greek nor Jew, neither Gentile nor Jew. All equal in wanting to honour God with different views, maybe, well, yes, passions, about which way we go to move from a period of uncertainty. So it's an exciting opportunity, but it's a time of great danger too, said Paul, if you don't hold to those truths. We are all seeking to honour the Lord, and we are all equal in our right to an opinion, to a belief, and to our place. Paul also reminds us of why such respect and equality of value and expression are important. Christ died for it. He also points out that it is God who is judge, not us. That's what the scripture says. That's what Jesus says. Do not judge others, he said, and God will not judge you. We're not here to judge each other. One of the commentators on this passage that I particularly like is a lady called Mary Shaw, who is a Lutheran pastor in Southern California at university there. She said this: the judgment forbidden is the easy, contemptuous dismissal of those who do not believe like us or vote like us. They are fools, we think, and we see no contradiction between sitting with them in church, of being Christians together, and yet despising them for their political views. If we move forward in this letter, a few verses down, Paul writes this: all of us will be accountable to God. All of us will be accountable to God. So we go forward through our desert, this place of uncertainty, either frightened by loss or excited by gain. But we all do so as equals, trying to honour God, one in Christ, knowing that we are all under the same judgment. We do not have to worry about judging our fellow sisters and brothers. As I said, Paul writes more a little further on, and he says this: the kingdom of God is not about food and drink. No, it's about righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. So let me re-express my real passion. It takes a while, doesn't it, to get underneath everything else, to discover what our real passion is. So my real passion in Christian leadership is to lead us all forward, but to do so in a way where together we discern what the Spirit is saying to us. Knowing we have different assumptions and ideas, acknowledging our frustrations and fears, but also knowing and celebrating that we are one in Christ, one equal body in Christ, and that we go into the future in righteousness and peace and joy in the Spirit. This is the radical Christianity that I'm passionate about leading us into. Of course, we have different ideas, different wants and needs. But to explore these together in an atmosphere of a common desire to honour God, to be one in Christ, to be free from the need to judge other people, well, that is any Christian leader's passion. To engage in our exercise of exploration in the righteousness, in the peace, and in the joy of the Holy Spirit. Now that's exciting. That is stimulating. That is something to thank God for. Whether backwards or forwards is not a question of strength or weakness. Whether we do so in the right spirit, well, that is. All of us must share that passion to go on our Christian journey in righteousness, in love, and in peace, in the power of the Holy Spirit. That's what freedom is. That freedom means that we are in a strong place to be able to acknowledge each other's fears, hold each other in our anxieties, be strong for each other, without judgment, without preconceived notions, but together ask God to show us what he wants us to do and be as his body on earth, and especially in this place. Amen. The choir anthem now. It's "Lord, for thy tender mercy's sake" by Farrant.
To
our prayers. We thank you, O Lord, for loving and caring for us all. We offer you our love and thanks by joining together to pray to you through the Son in the Holy Spirit. Give us joy in our hearts as we pray. We know that you hear us. We ask you to bless those who lead your church through the Holy Spirit and pray for the church to rediscover the foundations of the gospel. We pray for our parish that the Holy Spirit will inspire us in moving forward in our journey. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Worldwide, dear Lord, we ask you to help our leaders understand and act on the need to ensure the common good of all people, whoever they are. Guide our leaders to make the right decisions, morally and ethically, and thereby to make the world a safe, peaceful, and more equal place. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Dear Lord, give hope and strength to those suffering COVID-19. We give thanks for the people who are treating and supporting them. Be with all who have died and their families. In your mercy, give strength and hope to all those whose circumstances and situations, including ongoing illness, poverty and unemployment, make life really sad and difficult. Be with them all and with us as we comfort them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Open our hearts to all those in our parish and elsewhere who need help and friendship. We thank you for the goodness and giving of so many in our communities who reflect your teaching in the love and care they show daily in their words and deeds to others. They do not want or look for any thanks except the knowledge that they do your will. Help us to mirror their Christian love and bless them, dear Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pause a moment. And as we become aware of our breathing and relax in the presence of the Lord, let us humbly tell him what is deepest in our hearts, for he knows us, loves us, and forgives us. And as we do this, the choir will sing, O Lord, hear our prayer.
Thank you.
Father, we feel loved, we feel forgiven, we feel saved. Thank you for Jesus Christ, your Son, who died for us on the cross and rose again from the dead, and who offers us true peace and true hope. Help us to hold on to him and to follow him, the way, the truth, and the life. Amen. And the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Lord God, you have called your servants to ventures of which we cannot see the ending. By paths as yet untrodden, through perils unknown, give us assurance of forgiveness and renewal, so that in confidence we may go forward with good courage, not knowing where we go, but only that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and for ever. Amen. We end our singing this morning with a great hymn of praise, All Creatures of Our God and King. prayer and a blessing. Lord, as we take our worship, praise and prayer into our daily lives, may our faith be strengthened and our lives be sustained through the love of our Heavenly Father. May we feel the presence of our Saviour walking beside us and know the power of the Spirit in both our actions and our words. Help us always to proclaim the good news of unconditional love for all people. Amen. May the love of Jesus Christ bring you wholeness. The grace of God the Father grant you peace. The breath of the Holy Spirit instill in you passion, and the unity between them give you strength for this day and every day. Amen. Thank you for being with us today. I hope you have a great week. Our service closes with the organ voluntary, played as ever for us by our organist Ian. Goodbye.